Hello everyone and welcome to another Secret Sunday session. Today I am joined by Mr. Paul Ruse and I am very grateful to have him here today with us all the way from Hawaii. And just to start off, who is the Paul Ruse? I know you from Nurture Her and our previous experiences together, but for those of the people that are not aware of who you are, who are you?
Yeah, well, so I started playing AFL football back in 1980, 81, 82. So I was a sort of semi-professional football. So back then, you know, it wasn't full-time like it is now. So that was a really interesting experience to work and play football. So I played with the Fitzroy Football Club and then I left Fitzroy at the end of 1995 and went and played for the Sydney Swans for 4 years and was lucky to play in a grand final in 96, but we didn't win it. And then I started coaching the Sydney Swans midway through 2002 when the then current coach, Rodney Eade, resigned and they put me in as a coach. And I was really fortunate to coach the club to a premiership in 2005 and retired from coaching in 2010. Did a lot of media work and worked for the Swans Academy then, you know, which was a real passion of mine, junior footy. And then I got asked to come back and coach the Melbourne Football Club, which was in a pretty precarious position at the time, and agreed to do that on the basis that it'd be a 3 year period. And I'd also groomed someone to take the role. So I coached Melbourne for 3 years. And that's sort of the sporting story. I now run a business with some partners called Performance by Design, and where you and I met as at the Nurture Group business and wellness retreats, which I really enjoyed doing them. So, you know, really combining that notion of small, medium business and wellness and getting some great speakers talking about all things business, but all things health as well. I mean, one of the best sayings I've heard is, off, you know, is your own health will determine the health of your business. So, yeah, as you saw, we get up in, you know, in the morning, do a bit of yoga or running or stretching or whatever you want to do on the beach. And Tammy takes some meditation, my wife, and then we get into some really cool speakers on business and health. And yeah, so that's hopefully gives everyone a bit of a understanding of my background and also what I do now.
Awesome. I want to now look a little bit and reflect on your journey personally. Why did you decide to enter this health space?
I think I'm really fortunate being involved in an AFL club. I mean, by the very notion of being an athlete, it's healthy because you're training all the time. You know, it's not that you go into it wanting to be healthy. You go into it because you want to be an AFL player. But the extension of that is clearly the amount of exercise we do, the amount of weights we do. You know, we have dietitians. And as, I guess, as it got more professional, which was probably when I went to Sydney in 1996, I pretty much became full-time footballer. Before that, I was always working. So it truly is a high-performing industry. And looking at life in general and now being in business and in corporate world, I think, well, I know that general public and the corporate world can take a lot out of sport. Now, not everyone's going to play for the Swans or not everyone's going to run at the Olympics, or, but this notion of health, we have to take way more seriously, you know, and we have to educate each other way more and we have to help each other way more. So I guess it really was just an extension of what I love. I still love just going for a run. Nothing, you know, I'm not a marathon runner and I'm not someone that gets on a bike for 4 hours. You know, I enjoy just running for 3 or 4 Ks and just going to the gym and throwing some weights around for 20 minutes and, you know, playing golf and tennis. So I'm really active, but I think that's the key to it. Just, you know, helping each other and understanding what health is and understanding the healthier you are. You know, I believe the happier you are, and the more well-balanced you are anyway.
Yeah. Back when you were playing, was the health space such a big thing? Like, were you told to look after your physical and mental health?
No, not at all. I mean, I came to Fitzroy, as I said, as a 17-year-old in about 1980 was my first experience. And it was just train as hard as you possibly could. Train longer, train harder. I mean, there was some science behind it because we had some great fitness coaches and great weights coaches, but we didn't really, I think we had a psychologist, but not, didn't come that often. We didn't really have a dietitian and there was certainly no discussion around mental health and so forth. But I think, you know, my sons are 24 and 26 and I think if I look at them, the difference for me, it was a really simple life. So it was a healthy life away from football, even before I got to Fitzroy. Like I went to school, didn't have any homework, came home, didn't have any PlayStation game or Facebook or Instagram or whatever. Basically, I put my bag down, had my 4 pieces of Vegemite on toast and ran outside and played tennis, basketball, football, rode to my mate's house. So it was a really healthy lifestyle. I think even though football has evolved and these things have come in, psychologists and dietitians and meditation and all that, and they've been extremely worthwhile, a lot of it's sort of been forced on the clubs because of the lifestyle and how it's changed over so many years and what people have to face now compared to, you know, what I did when I was growing up. So again, those sort of things probably happened as we started to get full-time, which was in that sort of mid-90s when we started to take that seriously. And now, yeah, my last coaching was 4 years ago. You know, it was very much at the forefront, you know, talking about mental health, discussing with the players, psychologists. So it was very much at the forefront, as you see now with, you know, some of the leading advocates or ex-sports people around the notion, this space of mental health.
Do you think that it's necessary that the players now have the option to do meditation and to see psychologists? Do you think that's necessary for them?
Well, I think Wayne Swass is a great mate of mine. He does a lot in this space with Pucker Up. And one of the things that I think resonated with me, because often when we talk about mental health, we think about someone's mental ill health. But everyone has mental health. It's like physical health. So I think the good thing now, it's still got a fair way to go, and I'm sure Wayne would agree, at least we're just talking about mental health. It doesn't mean mental ill health. It just means, how are you on the inside? How are you physically? How are you feeling? So it just makes sense that we're all now starting to think about, you know, meditation, mindfulness, gratitude, you know, talking to psychologists about, you know, the emotions and letting it go, or writing it out, or how I can help. So we just got to be a little bit careful, I think, at times when we're talking about mental health, people shy away. Oh, I'm fine. No, we're not saying you're not fine. Everyone has mental health. And it was really interesting when Wayne said that. I was like, no, you're actually right. We all have mental health. Yeah. Some people's mental health, like their physical health, is a 10 out of 10. Some people's mental health, like the physical health, is a 1 out of 10. But we all should be thinking about it 100%.
Yeah. When you said you were coaching and practices like meditation and more of the well-being approaches started coming in to help the players, how did the players respond to having to do those sort of things?
Yeah, so I got Tammy to come in, I think, in 2003, which was quite groundbreaking then. You know, back then, you know, to have meditation in 2003. Tammy and I started learning, you know, about 7 years before that or what have you. But look, the players are really good. I mean, the players at a footy club are really inquisitive. They're really interested. But we didn't force it down their throats. So we said, whoever wants to do it can do it. Yeah, and there was no coincidence that our better players and our leaders started to do it. Brett Kirk, Craig Bolton, you know, Adam Goods, those sort of guys. And we did a group with the young players as well. They really embrace it because they're really inquisitive. Fast forward to when I was at Melbourne, it was compulsory then, and we made it part of what we did, because it's that important to understand. And it's interesting, you know, if you do a lot of background checks on some of the world's most successful athletes and business people, a lot of them meditate. I think Tim Ferriss did a list of the top 100 most successful people, and 90% of them were actually meditators, which was, I suppose, not surprising to me. But it's more mainstream now. But I think people, Australians, people still see it as, whether it's a Buddhist theory or whatever. But in reality, you know, Tammy explains it better than I, because she's got a PhD in it and done a dissertation. But the best way to explain it just gives your mind a rest and gives you clarity. And so there's really, you know, really clear improvements you're going to make in your life. And there's so many papers that have been done on it, and it has a significant advantage to all aspects of your life, as I said.
Yeah. I want to talk a little bit now about, I feel like there's a strength stigma in the sporting world. Did you find when you were coaching that a lot of the players felt like there was a lot of pressure on them to perform a certain way? And do you think that's necessary pressure for players?
Yeah, it's interesting, because when I touched on before about a high-performing industry, and the teams that I've been involved in the AFL is truly a high-performing industry. Now, the reason I say that is because there is pressure. I mean, it's just part of what we do. So you have to embrace that pressure. But with that pressure comes solutions, so which is a good thing, because when we see a player struggling, we find them a solution. So what I noticed over a period of time is players became more receptive to asking for help. So we are really leaders in that space. And the number of times I would have a player come into my office and sit down and say, look, Paul, you know, I'm really struggling. I said, mate, what's happening? And they explain it. And the weight of the world would be lifted off their shoulders. And it became over, I started coaching to midway 2002. So let's say, certainly it happened quickly at Sydney, but you know, mid 2000 and you know, 2005, 2000, it became a really safe environment. And we have to create a safe environment at a workplace, at a home place, at a local footy club, a local netball club. We have to start providing really safe environments. And a footy club is a really safe, or a good footy club is a really, really safe environment. And through that safety and through that wanting to create solutions, we have created solutions. Meditation teachers like Tammy, psychologists coming in, other experts coming in, breathing experts coming in. So we find solutions because we generally want our people to show up the best they can be, and not just about football. We had a great saying at the Sydney Swans was about, you know, not coming, leaving the club as a better person than when you first arrived. Not a better player, but a better person as when you first arrived. So with the pressure, you have to understand it, but it does provide solutions. But like anything, some players really struggle with the pressure, you know, and it is the reality of the game, and we try and deal with it as best we possibly can.
Yeah, wow. It's awesome to hear that even in, yeah, such a high pressure environment, that players are even seeking help and asking for help, because I know men's stigma around mental health is such a big thing. So it's great to hear that professionals are seeking that help.
Yeah, I think you got to commend the clubs, and you know, there's been a number of players. Tom Boyd, I think one of the most recent, who played the Bulldogs, was a number one draft pick and retired from the footy club and came out public, said, I'm struggling. And when that happens, particularly in the men's space, it allows, you know, the bricklayer, the accountant, the teacher, the male that's struggling to come home and say to the wife, you know, I'm really struggling, you know, because they see that in, you know, their role model, or they see that in this big, brave, tough, supposedly manly environment of AFL. But in reality, it is true, but it's not, you know, and Tammy explains it really well, because Tammy came in meditation, and some of the best meditation and some of the best people she'd meet is in football clubs, because the players are genuinely want to be there and want to be successful. But as I said, the space has been created that's really safe, and the players are really prepared to have honest and open and authentic conversations. And that doesn't happen at a lot of workplaces. And I know now, because the company, as I said, with Performance by Design, we work with a lot of corporations, and an AFL club is a far safer environment. And to your point, it allows these conversations to come out. And it's a really good environment for the men's space, and really good leader in the men's space.
Yeah, wow. And why do you think that this space and men coming forward and talking about, you know, when they're struggling, why do you think that didn't start back when you were playing? Why has it come out now?
Yeah, I think it's generational. You know, like I love my dad, obviously. We had a great relationship with my dad, and he's passed away since, you know, about 3 years ago. But, you know, he was a stoic man that went to work, and, you know, he clearly defined job, you know, get up in the morning, get to work early, come home, sit around the table, have dinner, you know, and a gentle man. So he wasn't a hard man necessarily, but we didn't share our feelings, you know. So when I started playing football as a 17-year-old, you know, that was my role model, or my role model was my dad, you know, and there was nothing wrong with that. So when I went down to Fitzroy, stoic, work hard, this is my role, Yeah, and I had great role models at Fitzroy as well, you know, and still to this day, they're some of my best mates, Laurie Serafini, Mickey Conlon, Gary Wilson, Scotty Clayton, Matty Rendell. But we could talk about anything, but just not certain things, because none of us sort of grew up in an era where we talk about our feelings. So thankfully, and I talked to my boys about it, you know, they need to be better versions of me. You know, they've got to be better. They've got to take the positives of what I was able to do and also look at me and say, well, Dad never cried or Dad was never this. I don't want to be like Dad, you know, and I think I learned from my dad some of the things that I didn't want to be and some of the things I did want to be. And that's what I'd ask my boys, Dylan and Tyler, pick the best parts of me and cut out the worst parts. You know, and the worst parts are some of the things I learned from my dad. So make sure you can have conversations. Make sure you do show your feelings. Make sure you are able to cry and talk about things. You know, and I think it's just a generational shift. But certainly when I went to Fitzroy, and also it was a time factor. You know, we'd get there. Yeah, we'd work. So I'd get there at 4:30 and put my training clothes on and run out on the training track and not really have time to have meetings or meet with psychologists or anything like that. So it's a far better environment. Even though my environment at Fitzroy was fantastic, for that time, it's a far better environment now than when I was. And so it should be. And hopefully in 20 years' time, it'll be better again.
Yeah. Do you find that now that you're exposed to all of the new shifts and the meditation and talking about your feelings, are you able to do that now?
Well, not as good as I would like, you know, because habits are really, really hard to break. So if you've done something, I'm 57 now, I'm aware of it. You know, I think that's the big thing. You know, I'm aware when I need to have those conversations. You know, but again, it's hard when you've grown up in that environment. So I think that awareness, but I think allowing my boys to be emotional, and you know, hopefully that's a good sign for them that even though it's difficult for me, that I will create a space for them to be able to do it. You know, that's the most important part.
Yeah. And if I could just ask from, I guess, a female perspective, because I know females, we generally connect by talking about how we're feeling and resonate and relate, but trying to understand where, I guess, as you said, your generation and males come from, what is it? Is there a fear of, I guess, exposing your internal feelings?
Yeah, I think initially, yeah. Again, if we sort of go back to the 80s and early 90s, and we'll progress the conversation as I go through it. I think there was just an uncertainty around what it meant because none of us had heard it. So to bring something like that up was sort of was so foreign, you know. Mm-hmm. Then because something's foreign, then there's that fear that you're talking about. I think as it progressed, it's, okay, when's the right time? And I'm happy to talk about it. So then it's about creating that space, you know, and now footy clubs are really good at having authentic conversations, saying, right, guys, does anyone want to share anything today? And setting those platforms and setting those environments. I think as we're moving forward now, what are we, 2021, that younger generation hopefully can have those conversations. So they don't have the fear and they know when and where to speak. We've still got a way to go as men. But I know it's certainly progressed a long, long way. But yeah, it's sort of hard to pinpoint because everyone's different. But I think uncertainty, fear, and right time, right place are probably the three biggest impediments over the last sort of 20 to 40 years.
Yeah, wow. And are your boys very open with you about talking about their feelings now because you're so expressive about doing that?
Yeah, look, I mean, Dylan's amazing. He works in that space with 16, 17, 18, 19-year-old boys, which is incredible. Like, he mentors them, and through his study and through his what he's done, he's also got a couple of partners, which is Momentum Lifestyle, and they do a lot of work around the men's space. So he's really well equipped to mentor people but talk about it. Yeah, and often he'll challenge me around that. Tyler is probably a little bit more like myself, you know, in more the sporting and football and being in that environment. But yeah, I mean, we sort of encourage it. And I mean, Tammy's obviously, yeah, very good at expressing her feelings. So the good thing is they're prepared to have conversations with me, but they can also have them with mum as well, you know. So, you know, hopefully we've created the environment. Have I got a long way to go? Yeah, like I still, as a 57-year-old, it's something you've got to be conscious of and work on and create it. You know, for them, it's more natural, which is great, you know. So I've got to keep working on it, and I'll continue to try and create a safe space and have the conversations and make sure that it becomes more normal for Dylan and Tyler.
That's awesome. And now I'll talk a little bit about teamwork and that team building space. Do you think that everyone should be part of a team?
I think there's just, it's funny because I started playing footy, as I said, as a 17-year-old, and even in a team environment since I was probably 8. Went to Fitzroy, coached, and probably the last 3 years, not coaching and working in the corporate space, I probably have a greater appreciation now of how important it is. I mean, just the really basic, simple concepts, and not everyone has to play for Fitzroy or Sydney or win a premiership, but any interaction as a team and is incredibly important. And the thing that I fear most through the pandemic and through what's happening is isolation. Lack of connection, lack of team, lack of going into an office, lack of creating, because it's incredible. It's incredible to create something as a team. And we've really missed out on that in the last 6, 8, 9, 10 months. And I worry as we start getting back to whatever normal looks like, we forget about that. We forget about how important a team is, how important belonging to a team is, how important creating, you know, together and the connection. It is incredibly invaluable. All the concepts you learn from a team sport or being part of a team is incredibly invaluable to every single part of your life.
Mm. Why do you think that we need that connection so much? I mean, if we look at, COVID, for example, I think a lot of people have excelled working from home and doing that. But Why do you think, in your opinion, does connection is such an invaluable thing?
Yeah, and I'm not an academic. I guess my academic background stems from my life skills. I went to high school and completed year 12 at Donbot High School. So that's about as the extent of my... But I've done a lot of reading. I mean, everything around... A lot of stuff around depression and mental health is lack of connection. You know, it's fundamentally... It doesn't matter whether you... Because you're right... And people have said to me at the start of the pandemic, oh, I love being at home, I can see my kids. But as we've worked our way through it, I think we've understood a little bit more around what are we talking about when we're talking about connection? Because I think you can work at home and, you know, as you and I do a bit, as long as you're connected to someone or something or people or whatever. I've spoken to executives for the last 6 or 8 months and they've really struggled. You know, they've said, look, and my advice to them has been, get your computer, go down to the local coffee shop, open it up there. Don't bury yourself away in your home. Speak to the barista, speak to someone there, but just being around people. But fundamentally, we need connection because the research just unequivocally tells us that, you know, it's unequivocal. But my life experience tells me that as well. You know, as a team builder with Performance by Design and as a coach and as a leader of Fitzroy in Sydney, I've seen how incredible it is when you bring people together and you create something together. Really difficult to do when they're in their pods all the way around New South Wales or Australia or whatever. You know, so I think we'll change, but my advice is to companies, never ever think you're going to build a high performing team if you've got all your staff working from home, because it's not going to happen. It simply is not going to happen. 3 days in the office, you know, 2 days at home in the working week, fantastic. 4-1, you know, whatever it might look like. You know, it'll change. But if you think you're going to build a high-performing team and everyone's going to be sitting at home, good luck, because that company that gets it right is just going to go past you at a million miles an hour.
Yeah. Do you think technology has disconnected us more than ever?
Oh, 100%. You know, it's unbelievable how... Yeah, I mean, it's sad. Yeah, it really is. It's really sad how, you know, mobile phones and Instagram and all these, you know, social media platforms, and we know it. I guess that's the strange part as human beings. We know it, but it's in some ways it's become so intoxicating or whatever it is that, we've given away our power, and it's really, what's that show called? The Social Dilemma. I think it was called.
Yes, on Netflix. Yeah, the series. Netflix, yeah.
You know, and I think we know it, and even the people that created it know it, but they still created it. You know,
yeah.
Because I always say this: it's like, what drives society? Money, power, and selfishness. Yeah, let's be really clear on what drives human race: money, power, and what's in it for me. And that's really sad. And hopefully, that will change over time. And if it doesn't, we're not heading to a really good place.
Yeah, I think a lot of young people these days as well say that they're socially connecting with people online through liking, following, commenting. Do you think that's a necessary social connection?
Well, I mean, people's reality is their reality. And I probably, it's funny, I had this experience with Dylan, and I went to the tap to get a bottle of water. That's to fill up my water. I started drinking my water, and I love water. Something, I can't remember the exact comment. Goes, Dad, didn't you have bottled water growing up? And I'm like, well, how would he know that I didn't? When he was born, he's had. So it was a bit of a light bulb moment. And to your point about Instagram and Facebook and all that, it doesn't really matter what happened before, because they don't know what happened before. I guess all I can do with my experience is to explain what it was like to go and kick the ball in the park or play cricket or play basketball, as opposed to sit in front of the PlayStation and play Fortnite. I can only explain that, but they're living a different reality to my reality. So I think it's just through conversation, through your generation and my generation talking about it, and me at my generation understanding, you know, what it means to you and social media and all that sort of stuff. But equally, your generation understanding what it was like and the benefits that have been given up, and the problems that have been created, and me understand the opportunities have been created. So it's just a conversation that we just got to keep on having.
Yeah. Do you think that's encouraged the selfishness that we're experiencing, I guess, today, that everybody, we sort of just have it all? As you said, we haven't really experienced where we don't have that privilege to go and, I guess, not have water, if we use that for an example. Do you reckon that's encouraged selfishness?
Yeah, I think one of the biggest things, because it's a great point, one of the biggest things I see is my role models were see, touch, and feel. All right. So they were see, touch, and feel. So my role models, I knew them. So school teacher, mum and dad, footy coach, basketball coach, you know, mates, parents. So they couldn't bluff me. They couldn't put one over me. They couldn't. And a lot of what I saw was their behavior. You know, their behavior was good person, work hard. What your generation has now as role models, Instagram, you know, Kim Kardashian, Dan Bilzerian. You have no idea how they live. No idea whatsoever. All you see, and based on that, we have this sense of, well, why can't I do it? Yeah, but you can. But what you got to do is connect the dots. If you work hard, and you might have to get a job in a cafe for 2 years. You might have to paint a building, you know, the paint company. You might have to be a brickies laborer. There's this lack of connection between success and hard work. That's the biggest thing that I see now. And the good thing is you can aspire to do these certain things, but the missing piece is really important. It's an incredibly important missing piece. The connection piece, the networking piece, the hard work piece, and all the, I talk about climbing a ladder. You know, when you climb a ladder, you go one step, two step, three step. When I was a kid, it's climb the ladder. For your generation, it's skip step two, three, and four and put my foot on step five. Often that results in you falling down the ladder.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's what's happening based on, you know, social media, because these role models are just unachievable. These podcasts are really interesting, but most of these people on podcasts have been doing their work for, you know, 20 years or 30 years. Or they've inherited their money from their bloody fathers and started a business, but they don't want to tell you that. That's not That's not selling me any marketing stuff or anything like that. You know, that. So there is a lot of bluff and bluster and misinformation. And I think it becomes hard to understand what's real and what's not real.
Yeah. So I guess how do we, for a young person that doesn't, as you said, there's all that kind of living in a fantasy, really. How do we get away from that and really see the realness and have influences that are you see, you touch and you feel when we're in an environment that constantly tells us not to do that?
I still think innately we know, and this is the challenge for everyone. The challenge is to take personal responsibility. And that doesn't matter what, that's not generational. That's never going to change. That'll be in 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. Doesn't matter where we head. And I think what we've started to do is hand over our power. So it's not my problem. You know, and we've got to take back that personal responsibility. And that would be my message to, if you're talking generational, your generation, don't blame Instagram. Don't blame Facebook. Don't blame, you know, whatever the social media platform is, TikTok or whatever the new one is. Take personal responsibility, you know, because really deep down, we know what a good person is. But it's easy to sort of say, I know what a good person is, but that person's got a lot of followers and, you know, a lot of likes and seem to make a lot of money and that's what they do. We know what's right and wrong. I firmly believe we still know what's right and wrong. But we have to take back our power and we have to start taking personal responsibility for our actions. If we don't do that, then we'll keep getting led down the garden path by people that don't really care. Well, most of these influencers don't care about you, don't care about me. What do they care about? Money. That's all they care about. And we've got to change the narrative around, you know, this lack of self-interest and start to talk about how can I help you, genuinely help you. And when you have a role model you can see, touch and feel, you know whether they're genuinely helping you or not. When it's someone on an Instagram, you know, thing that just puts up a post and or puts up a product and you go and buy, you have no idea what goes on inside their head. So my message is take back your power, make informed decisions, and don't be treated like a fool.
Yeah. Wow. It's a very great advice. So thank you for sharing that. When you talk about as well team and being in a team environment, and you said that it doesn't have to just be a sporting team, what other teams can there be and how can people, I guess, find their team?
Yeah, it's a bit like finding your tribe. I mean, your team can be, I can't remember the exact numbers, but I think there's some research around, you know, you surround yourself. I think it's the 3 to 5 people that most influence you. That's a team as well. I mean, if you create a team of really, really good people, and often those good people have slightly different interests and belief systems and all that sort of stuff, but you get on well and you understand where you fit. So your team could be your family. You know, your team could be your 5 or 6 best friends. Your team is your workplace. Your team could be your netball team or your sporting team, et cetera, et cetera. But again, understanding basic principles is really, really important. So with a family, the family dynamics, where do I fit in? What are our family values? I mean, how many families sit down as a group and say, what do we want to stand for? What are our family values? You know, and what are we going to hold each other accountable to? And what's my responsibility to you and your responsibility to me? No one does that. But there's a team and your most important team. Do the exercise as a group. Guys, what do we stand for? What are we going to reward in this family? What are we going to challenge in this family? What's our personal brand? You know, when I go outside, you know, as a ruse, you know, what is a ruse? What does a ruse represent? You know, so there's one way to do it. As a company, same thing. What do we stand for? What's our purpose? What's our values? What are our behaviors? Start talking about roles in our organization. You know, my role complements your role. But what I find a lot is these roles are so blurred and no one wants to hand out any power. You know, and no one, you know, I'm a leader, but I don't want to give any power to everyone. So you have about 3 people all doing the same job. And then eventually the person down below says, well, I'm going to stop doing it because even though it's my role, they're doing it anyway. So they've got no notion of, so there's so many different ways to practice it and so many different teams we can bounce off.
Yeah. When you talk a little bit about fitting into a team and knowing where you fit into that team, I think a lot in this new world, this generation, and it's probably happened for generations, but that fit in culture of needing to fit into a particular space. What about if you feel that you don't fit in, that this is not your type of people? Are you just supposed to, I guess, give up that you don't have your team or find another one?
Yeah, it's probably a number of things. I think, again, getting back to generationally, there's nothing wrong with getting to a place and not loving it. Like, you're still going to learn from it. So you're still going to go through that stages. So my first piece of advice is, let's say someone walks into an organization and, yeah, feels a bit alienated and doesn't feel like they fit in. That's okay. That can be just part of life. You know, work on it. Learn from it. Learn what the behaviors are. Are these people, is it me or is it them? Oh, okay, there's a little bit of me. I'm a bit selfish. I'm a bit arrogant. That's why they don't sort of respect me. I'll change my behavior. But equally, I'm not going to change that behavior because I really believe that we're not an honest company. And I think I'm an honest person. So try and change their behaviors as well. All right, so it's a process. And then if you get to the point where you're banging your head against the wall just for the sake of stopping, stop. What's the definition of stupidity? Doing the same thing over and over and over and over again and getting the same result. That's when you know, well, this is not my team. This is not my tribe. This is not where I want to be. Does that make sense?
Yeah, for sure.
It's not always simple and black and white. And, you know, you've got to go through uncomfortable situations. You've got to learn. And that's part of, I guess, my generation, as opposed, I think, sometimes to your generation, it's, oh, I don't like this team. I've got to go. No, you'll still learn. Try and fit in, try and change their behavior, try and find a voice. And if at the end of the day, after a year or 2 years, it's not what you want to do, then get out. But you will have learned some valuable experiences on the way, and then you'll have much better understanding of the team you want to be part of. Mm-hmm. And you will have changed and you will have become a better person, but you will have then said, as I said before, I'm not going to change this. I'm not going to compromise this part of who I am. That part, yeah, I am a little bit arrogant and I often don't say that I was wrong and I've learned that I need to do better. So you leave a better person and you find a better group of people to hang out with.
Yeah. Okay. And in terms of qualities of a team, you know, I remember in primary school, we used to write down a piece of paper, what does a team mean to you, and write down all the qualities. What do you think, if we're looking at qualities, you need to have an effective team?
Yeah, I think firstly, the leaders, if you look at the team and you sort of said, well, there's a leadership group in your team and whatever, leaders have to have great self-awareness. Yeah, leadership has changed so dramatically over the years. You know, self-awareness, the ability to communicate honesty, creating a really safe environment, being authentic. So if the leaders can set that up, it sets the parameters really well. Lack of ego sets the parameters really well for the rest of the team. And then it's about, okay, well, how do we want to behave? And everyone understanding exactly how we behave. And then what's my role in this team? And being valued, my role being really valued in the team. You know, and everyone having self-awareness and everyone understanding that this is a great company and I'm going to communicate and I'm going to be honest, but I'm going to be respectful. It's funny, what I've noticed is people are really good at understanding terms, as in they can talk it, but they can't live it and breathe it. We all sort of know what, you know, knowing your role is, or being respectful or being honest or treat people the way, but people don't want to live it. People can talk the talk, but then the ability to walk the walk. What's a great team? A great team walks the walk. A great team sets up the environment and holds each other accountable and lives and breathes it and rewards good behavior and challenges poor behavior. We all know it, but yet, let me tell you the one thing about setting up a good team. As a leader, you're held responsible for your behavior. Most leaders don't want that. Now, hang on. You mean I'm responsible for my behavior and I have to be a leader and a role model? No. I didn't sign up for that. That's okay for the rest of the team. That's why it becomes so challenging for leaders, because they don't want to be held accountable. So some of the worst companies we work with, make no mistake, the CEOs are shocking. The executive team, shocking. but they don't want to get any better. They're happy for the rest of the team. Oh, no, work with them, you know, but we don't want to hold ourselves accountable. We all know it, but again, the ability to live it and breathe it is way more difficult.
Yeah. Isn't it an ego thing that people don't want to walk the walk?
I mean, ego is one of the greatest impediments to, you know, to success. There's no question. And the more I've been involved in sport, the more I've been involved in the corporate world, ego is a huge impediment. Because what is ego? Let's break down the term. Ego is, I'm more important than you. I know everything. You know nothing. It's not a great starting point. So by the very nature, now you have to, if you trim it back a bit and say, you know, in the lowest form, in a sense of ego, oh, I'm confident in what I do. I can get the job done. And if I've had a down day, I'm going to bounce back because, you know, I believe in myself. That's good. So we need a certain amount of ego. But I'm talking about that egomaniac. I mean, what's going on in the world now has never been a great example of leaders with ego, egomaniacs. We have egomaniacs just roaming the planet and destroying the planet, you know.
A new species has arrived.
Oh, it is. It's a new species of egomaniacs. We've got this new species of just egomaniacs that are running rampant. And they're not holding themselves accountable. And no one, amazingly enough, you know, no one's holding them. I mean, what's happened in America has just been incredible. As someone that's come to America for the best part of 30 years, I've never seen anything like it. And I'm not talking about politics. So let's forget Republicans and Democrats. You know, I'm not talking about politics, but I'm talking about pure leadership. It has been incredibly divisive, incredibly toxic, and built around a complete egomaniac. And what's probably been more surprising is no one in the party has held him accountable. You know, so the ego has just got bigger and bigger. And what we're seeing it in Australia at the moment with our premiers, you know, it's like a competition, you know, who can have the greatest self-interest is just, it's just incredible. And I'm going to give a shout out to the New South Wales Premier. I think she's, you know, above all the other premiers, at least showed, you know, some of the traits that we've talked about. But for the others, it's been a competition of who's got the biggest ego.
Do you think people are a bit fed up with all of that? And that's why I think in the business world, I find there's a lot of people starting their own businesses. And do you think that's because people are fed up with, yes, their egos and being told what to do, and they're like, well, I'm going to do it my way?
Yeah, there's some research. I think it was, and I don't want to discredit anyone, but I think it was Brené Brown. The first people to leave a dysfunctional company are the best people because their self-worth is too high to stay. So think about that. That becomes really dangerous. Mm-hmm. So if you've got a really bad leader, your company just plummets because the people that leave are not the worst performers, they're the best performers. And to your point, you're 100% right. People that have got self-worth and people have got great traits that we've spoken about, they just leave because they're just not going to put up with it. And I think we're seeing a lot now. We're seeing, but the flip side is, and I'll be positive here because we've talked a lot about the negative aspects of it. We do have a lot of great leaders in business, and I'm seeing a flip and I'm seeing a change and I'm seeing this next generation of leaders that do understand about self-awareness, do understand about honesty, do understand about respect, do understand about authenticity and having open conversations and all those sort of things. So we are shifting, which is fantastic. And the ones that shift quicker are going to do the best. Yeah, the ones that don't shift, you'll find you'll lose your really, really good staff, and they will go out on their own, or they will go to another great company, and that company will just continue to get better. So you're 100% right.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much for joining us today. It's been very informative about everything there is. We've discussed a lot of topics, but I just want to ask, is there any advice that you can offer, whether it's a person starting their own business or a person that's trying to find their team, whether it's their family or their group network or their friends? What advice can you offer to someone that's just searching or seeking that connection?
As I said, I think we know it. My advice is follow your heart. you know, like I think there's so much information out there, and we get pulled in so many different directions. And I always felt, I know what's right and I know what's wrong. And I think we all know that. So follow your heart, follow what you know is right, and don't get pulled in a direction because of an Instagram follower or because of the media you're reading or because your friends have all started to do that. Yeah, understand it is hard work. Yeah, there's some things that never going to change, I'll tell you. Hard work results in success. Yeah, you can have some lows, you're going to have some highs, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So we sort of know it, but my advice is understand simple concepts and follow your heart. You know, follow your gut, follow your what you know is right, and don't get pulled off your path.
Awesome. That's amazing. And get some better role models.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. Awesome. Yeah, role models are important.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for joining us today all the way from Hawaii. I really appreciate it. And thank you everyone out there who also joined in on this Secret Sunday session. I am very grateful to have Paul here with us today and to have all you guys out there listening and watching. And we will catch you all next time for another Secret Sunday session. And thank you, Paul.
Thank you.